Okay, okay, I'll go first.
I have a little thing to say. My father.
Thank you.
Jesus said, I am
the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whosoever believes in me shall never die. Because I live, you also shall live. We have come to celebrate the life of Ruth Patricia Foley this morning. We've come to praise God as the source for the gift of her life, her love, her energy and passion, her joy. We've come together as family to acknowledge our loss and support each other. We come together as church to witness to each other the hope of the resurrection. And we are glad that you're here at Second Presbyterian this morning. And for all those who are worshiping online, we welcome you. Let us stand for the call to worship. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who die in the Lord. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
of invocation. Eternal God, you love us with an everlasting love, and you alone can turn the shadow of death into morning. Help us now to wait upon you with reverent and believing hearts. Speak to us in these moments of eternal things, that as you have prepared a place for us, you may also prepare us for that place. Through the comfort of the scriptures, may we find hope. May we be lifted above any distress into the light of your countenance and the joy of your presence. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. For me, Pat was someone who let the light shine through. So I have chosen scriptures this morning that bear the theme of light and love. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his holy temple. And Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light into all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. And finally, if I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but have not love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have all prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and gain all knowledge, and if I have faith to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. For love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love believes all things, bears all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. And this love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when that which is complete comes, the partial will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but one day we shall see face to face. Now I know only in part, but one day I will know all things fully, even as I am fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide in these three. And the greatest of these is love. This morning, we give thanks for the life of Pat Foley, who touched all our lives. Born in Roseland Hospital, she was raised during the Depression with both parents working, and she often took on the jobs and duties of cooking and cleaning. Raised by a father who was very well-read and a mother who worked hard and believed in a good education, she got her bachelor's degree at Chicago Teachers College and then her master's at Northwestern, a long relationship of honor with her. If you look at the photos after the service, you'll see that as a teacher in Chicago public schools, her face beamed as she saw her students through the completion of a school year. She especially enjoyed teaching civics and helping students understand constitutional law. And then as a guidance counselor, she used her quick mind to reason with students and help them find their way forward. She delighted to hear of their progress and was especially honored when they returned to the school to see her again and again. As an educator, she was a good colleague to all, supporting teachers' projects, helping to raise funds for scholarship, bettering our public schools. You all know she dressed to the nines, right? Stylishly and elegantly with Pat, everything was always in place. And she knew who she was. In her office upstairs was a sign that read, "A wild, weird, wacky, wonderful woman lives here." She and her mother moved to Campbell Avenue nearly 50 years ago, and for her, it was one of the best decisions of her life. She loved her home and loved the people on her block, and she enjoyed all the times they got together, even though I've been told that some of the children on the block thought she was a little bit of a Grinch. But everybody had to love Pat. Beside being a teacher and a good neighbor, she excelled at being an aunt. She loved family trips and vacations. She loved to celebrate birthdays and send cards and phone calls for anniversaries, and especially graduation, the different achievements and accomplishments of her nieces and nephews and their children, and she kept me up with the progress of each one. They were a constant joy for her. 10 years ago, she found love by bringing her companion Fanta into the home. And her dog was also a source of friendship and joy. I knew Pat well as an elder and deacon at Morgan Park Presbyterian Church. We prayed together in a prayer circle every Tuesday night for 10 years and was part of a book discussion group for another 10 years. She was especially known for working in tandem with her best friend, Lois Christie, and they comprised the wedding committee. In their eyes, weddings should be sophisticated, and just so. So each brought a sophisticated sense of beauty and taste to each service and ceremony we tried to do. Many years ago, Morgan Park Presbyterian was chosen to be a scene for a wedding by an independent film company. And as the actors and actresses came on site, Pat regaled them all by telling them stories about growing up on the South Side. Wherever she went, Pat was a big hit. Her wit was sharp, her sense of irony even sharper. She sparkled best in dialogue and conversation. With an active mind, she was philosophical about life in the modern world. She was always up to date and contemporary in her knowledge of current events. I can't tell you how many times her observations of society found their way into my Sunday sermons. Pat had such a practical and well-considered way of looking at our world. Pat's faith was an active faith. Growing up in Bethany Reformed Church in Roseland, her father sang in the choir, and she learned to appreciate good music. Her mother gave her a faithful piety. And at the church, the sermons of Dr. Hager, the pastor, impressed upon her the scriptural truths of being a disciple, which she took to heart. And she also had to deal with the cultural expectations of Dutch Calvinism, right, in Roseland. She was so impressed with her pastor, Pat said, "I know what God looks like. He looks like my pastor, Dr. Hager." She constantly reminded me, in her mother's words, that I was the Lord's anointed. A woman of prayer, Pat incarnated the love of God by putting prayers into action. She believed that following Jesus meant putting your shoulder to the plow and serving others in concrete ways. When a building project came up, she asked how it would be funded. At the end of the year, she asked how much was needed to help the church meet its budget. She read each annual report with care and concern. She loved the church because it had given her life and raised her up and gave her the faith that God worked through her. Wherever there was a need, she gave generously because she felt like God had blessed her so incredibly. Here at Second Presbyterian Church, I got to know her best by driving her to church and back on Sunday mornings and also driving her back and forth to Wednesday night Bible study. As you can imagine, Pat talked and I listened. That was our conversational pattern. Pat talked and I listened. But at the end of the evening, she'd always ask me something that she could do for me or a way that she could help me. Here at Second Presbyterian Church, Pat delighted in hosting coffee hour and often baked her famous cranberry muffins. Pat was someone we can all testify to that let the light shine through. She was the salt that flavors everything. Her colorful life brightened up each and all. Horace Bushnell wrote that every person's life is a plan of God. I think her greatest witness to all of us came during the last 3 years as she contracted cancer. Many times I visited her in the hospital, and I didn't think she would make it another day. But each time she rebounded with even more strength and more determination. I love to talk to Pat after each doctor's visit. She would always give a critical review and appraisal of each doctor's manner of caring and speaking with her. However, after debriefing, she carefully reviewed her options. For Pat, hope was about having options, about the choices before her. Not once, not twice, but three times, the treatments were effective. While all the nurses and aides were marveling at how this 89 or 88-year-old woman had overcome cancer, she was quick to point out the source. She believed with all her heart that her life was a demonstration of the faith that with God, all things are possible. One of my favorite moments, Denise remembers, after Pat got the call that she was cancer-free, Denise and I determined that we would have to celebrate with Pat. But how can you celebrate? So Pat dressed up, we piled into the car with her walker, and we went to Rainbow Cones, where we sat on the back tables and remembered the highlights and the wonderful moments of Pat's life over Rainbow Cones. A tender moment for me was her final stay in Little Company of Mary. One afternoon, I think, Pat knew the end was near. I came in, we talked, I prayed, read scripture, I shared Holy Communion with her. And then I got up to take my leave and leave her to her privacy, and she said, "David, would you just stay here and sit with me?" And for the next hour, we sat without words, but in the dearest and deepest communion. It was in that moment she knew and I knew this would be our last true moment together. On Saturday night, she was brought home to hospice care and a bed set up in her living room. And she was so happy to be in her home and to pet her dog, Fanta, and the smile on her face to be there is the smile I will always remember. Our Lord talked about abundant life in very visual and earthy terms. The one who said, who was the light of the world, told his disciples that you're the light of the world. The one who brought salt to flavor life so wonderfully told the disciples they were the salt that would make life truly wonderful. Pat, you brought so much joy into our lives. So much light and life, so much beauty and intelligence, so much color and brightness and liveliness, so much generosity, and so much love. We will miss you, but we trust there's more to life than the grave. And we trust that the last chapter of a person's life is only the beginning of a new chapter for the grace that always is and the love which never ends. Thanks be to God for the victory of Pat's faith. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you.
Can everyone hear me okay?
You need to turn on.
Hello? Hello?
Can you hear me now?
Okay, great. Well, Dave, those were some beautiful words. Hard to hold the tears back. So welcome, everyone. It's nice to see so many familiar faces. Thank you for joining us today at the Second Presbyterian Church of Chicago to celebrate Ruth Patricia Foley's life. As Pat's nephew, I feel honored to share with you some of the good memories I have had with my dear Aunt Pat. Before traveling down memory lane, let's talk about love. Death is not the end of relationships, for love endures all things. More than anything else, my Aunt Pat valued loving relationships. She deeply loved her mother, Carolyn Secrets Foley, her father, John Charles Foley, and her younger brother, Eugene Foley. She deeply loved her nieces and nephews. In fact, her love extended outward to include all the members of her extended family. If one word could sum up Ruth Patricia Foley's life, it would be love. Love for family, love for friends, love for the community, love for the plants and animals, and of course, a deep love for her church and God. I can remember the time when I visited my aunt for 4 glorious weeks. After unpacking my bags, I headed down to her kitchen for a glass of water. When my aunt saw me there, she said, "You are looking a little lean. I think you could use a few pounds. Here, take my credit card and for the next 4 weeks, buy whatever groceries you want." Besides thanking my aunt, I thought to myself, wow, what a loving thing to do. So I headed down to her local grocery store and bought some big fat steaks, some hamburger meat, French fries, mozzarella cheese sticks, corn on the cob, ice cream, and a lot of other very rich food. I did the cooking and we wined and dined like Midwestern royalty. Little did I know that my aunt's cholesterol and triglycerides had shot up through the roof. We didn't worry about a thing, for we could literally feel the deep love coursing through our veins. Let us move along to a different subject. As you all know, my aunt loved to talk, especially on the phone. For the last couple of years of my aunt's life, my wife Rebecca and I spoke with Pat on the phone for about 4 hours a week. She did 95% of the talking, and she would talk for hours. In fact, the incessant talking became so protracted that we decided to place our cell phone on speaker mode so we could do chores around the house. We would check in on the phone from time to time to see if she was still talking. Of course, she was always talking. In my aunt's defense, her conversations were honest, true, and interesting. She enjoyed talking about politics, religion, travel, and theology. She also enjoyed talking about her fashion purchases on QVC and HSN. Pat, we will always love your style. So my dear Aunt Pat passed away on January 31st, 2022 at around 4:30 in the morning. She was surrounded by family and friends before making her transition to heaven. On the evening of her death, David Neff, the pastor, gathered Denise and Greg, her caregivers, and Rebecca and I for an intimate dinner in her dining room. We chirped, quacked, and laughed, recalling all our good memories with Pat. Then my beautiful and lovely wife said, "We should say a prayer for Jesus." We looked at each other a little confused and thought, shouldn't we be praying for the fate of my aunt's soul versus praying for Jesus? Then Rebecca turned to us and said, "Let us say a prayer for Jesus so that Aunt Pat doesn't talk his ear off in heaven." Wow, prayers for Jesus. Amazing. Pat loved to work in her garden. She also loved entertaining, international travel, and poetry. My aunt particularly enjoyed the poetry of St. Francis of Assisi. I would like to share with you her favorite poem by St. Francis. This poem reflects my aunt's deep appreciation for the value of love. Here it goes. Dear Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Thank you, Ruth Patricia Foley, for having blessed us and the earth with your beautiful presence. We know you are shining down on us from heaven, from your family, your friends, and the community. We love you now and forever. Peace be with you. Amen. Thank you. We miss you, Pat.
Thank you, Dave.
So I have to lower the microphone for my brothers. So, and also, unlike my brother, I didn't prepare anything, so this is going to be quite spontaneous. I obviously knew Pat before Stephen, so I'm 8 years older than him and 10 years older than my sister. And what I can tell you about Pat is early in her life, after she graduated from college and got her master's degree, she really was a trailblazer. She and her best friend, Joy Regnier, who was tragically taken from us quite early in life and for whom we named my daughter's middle name is Joy, after Joy, traveled the world as two single ladies traveling everywhere. I mean, she went to China before Nixon did. She went to the Soviet Union when it was still behind the Iron Curtain. She came to visit us as family in Southeast Asia, traveling alone back then. There was pretty much no corner of the globe that my aunt didn't want to explore and bring those experiences back to her students. She loved to travel, she loved the adventure, and she loved the stories that she could tell as the result of those travels. The other thing that I wanted to talk about was Pat's faith. Pat's faith was very, very profound and touched me personally in many, many ways. Early in my life, I got cancer, and I was actually quite sick, and I had two very young children, my daughter, Kara, and my son, Christopher. And Kara was old enough at the time to be aware of what was going on and how sick I was. She must have been about 10, I guess. And Pat had come to visit at our house to help take care of me and sort of help keep my wife together with all the trauma that she was going through with me being so sick. And at one point, she talked to my daughter, and at some point in the conversation said, "I know my father's not going to die." And Pat said, "How do you know your dad's not going to die?" And because Kara quite earnestly said, "Because God told me so. God told her that I wasn't going to die, and together my daughter and my aunt rejoiced in the knowledge. And quite frankly, I'm here today as proof of that." So her faith was very profound, it was very strong, and it was a fervent belief that through God, all things were possible. So thank you.
Are there other family members or neighbors or friends? Please come forward at this time and we'll share a word. Then let us continue our service with prayer. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for all those dear to us who have died and are with you now. We name them in our hearts before you in silence. This morning, we give you thanks especially for Ruth, Patricia Foley, whom you've received into the arms of your mercy, for her love for others, her earnestness and seriousness, for her laughter and sense of humor, for her intelligence and her common sense, for her constant faith and the belief that you would work through her, for her continual acts of service, for the love of her brother and nieces and nephews, an extended family who gave her joy, for the resilience and strength of her character, her generous spirit. Lord, you are the light of the world. We thank you for all the ways she let the light shine through, for all the ways that she let your joy be expressed. Gracious God, this morning we pray that you will keep true in us the love by which we hold one another as family, as neighbors and friends. Help us cherish each other and keep our love for each other strong through each passing year. And grant us faith, Lord. Help us to believe in what we cannot see, trusting in your presence to lead us through all our years and reunite us with all that we love. And bring us to our final moment, to that heavenly banquet, the eternal communion. Help us see the light and radiance of your countenance. Help us to know the joy of your glorious eternal presence in the time that you give us. Help us yield our lives to you. All these things we pray, trusting in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Life, Father,
Thy name is joyful,
joyful. We adore thee. Please stand and sing. This is your moment to bloom and blossom. This is your time to live in the joyful love that God has given us through God's Son, Jesus Christ. And so rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. With God, all things are possible. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, communion of the Holy Spirit, and the companionship of one another go with us to bless us, that we may bless others. Amen. Let us greet one another in peace.